Thank you for the nice introduction. I think it became clear that I'm a little bit more involved in hematology than in oncology or particularly surgery. So I will use my talk to discuss several questions which I was organized by the organizers: the use of monoclonal antibodies in the treatment of leukemia, small molecules, so-called molecular targeting vaccination strategies. If I give a talk to the hematologists, my first slide is usually this one. So in the last decade, there are a lot of new approaches in leukemias and lymphomas. And one of the most important, this is not the topic of my day, of my talk today, is the evaluation of minimal residual disease. So in leukemia and lymphoma, you can detect one cell in 1/10,000 cells or even less in the bone marrow and blood. And this is now a new method to guide treatments. If a patient is MRD positive, the likelihood to relapse and to die is more than 90%. Even the patients are aware of these methods and ask for the results. If the likelihood is, if he is minimal residual disease negative, the chance of cure is 80 to 90%. So I will focus on these two topics: antibody treatment, molecular therapy in leukemia, and I am just choosing one example, the acute lymphoblastic leukemia, because I'm running a trial with 100 hospitals in Germany. There are nearly all patients, 85% of the patients are on the trial, and we have a couple of thousand patients. Now, in hematology, we had two decades of real frustration, and the only thing was to move a little bit around with chemotherapy to give high-dose methotrexate, to give higher doses of methotrexate or high-dose RSC, but now it has really changed. We have antibodies, and we have drugs, and the best is Gleevec, a new drug from Novartis, which is just directed against one fusion protein, and this fusion protein causes leukemia, for instance, in mice, and it inhibits specifically this drug. So it sold well, more than $1 billion in the meantime. The question is, however, if you have this new possibilities, what is the best and most intelligent way to combine it with your backbone of chemotherapy, which in leukemia is induction, consolidation cycles, and so on? So this is a question, because the number of patients is limited and you cannot explore everything. So we should design good trials. I show you one example: antibody therapy in adult ALL. The first thing is we have a bank from all leukemic patients in Berlin, a central lab, and we're collecting since 1984 the samples. So the first thing is to look to the leukemic cells and to see the antigen expression on the surface if you start with the antibody treatment. And there are several antigens expressed, but not for everything you have an antibody. So we selected rituximab, which is now an important biological treatment together with chemotherapy in non-Hodgkin lymphomas, and it has improved the results dramatically. Several publications in New England Journal of Medicine, and we have used it for the mature BLL in Burkitt non-Hodgkin lymphomas. This is just to show you, when we started in 81, all patients with Burkitt and with advanced Burkitt, I have to say, and mature BLL died. Then we moved to chemotherapy, six short cycles, and we could cure half of the patients. But then there was no further improvement, neither by increasing chemotherapy. The only result was toxicity. When we decreased the methotrexate, they died from relapse. So we decided to give to this treatment antibodies. So the patients receive six cycles of chemotherapy, details of no interest, and before each cycle, and thereafter two cycles of dosages of rituximab, the antibody, and in addition, this may be of interest for you, we give the patients a safe pre-phase. So the majority of our patients are Burkitt non-Hodgkin lymphomas, even if they have huge tumor masses in the abdomen or somewhere else, they respond very, very well. And we did not lose one of the patients during this phase, pre-phase, which consists of cortisone and cyclophosphamide. We did not lose out of 270 patients one, because it's a safe and gentle treatment, and then you go to the main thing. Now, we have now 270 patients in this study, chemo plus rituximab, and you see the majority of patients are Burkitt's, and next, please. Okay, and you see the results are dramatically improved. I could show a very nice curve, the Burkitt's, because they are now 86%. The young patients as well as the elderly. So we have a particular protocol for patients above 55, because we see also patients with mature BLL and Burkitt, which are older. So there is a substantial improvement by the combination of chemotherapy and a antibody treatment. There are now other antibodies under evaluation, like anti-CD52, anti-CD33. But for other important antigens, no antibodies are available. The new approach is we don't wait anymore that the patient has a relapse. We follow closely the minimal residual disease, and if a patient is positive, I told you the likelihood to relapse and to die is 90%. We have now treatments where we give the antibody or any other treatment just on the basis that the patient has remaining leukemia burden. Also, he is in complete remission, has a normal blood picture, is clinically doing well. This was very difficult in the beginning of the study to convince the physicians or the patients, because they said he is fine. Why should he have something strange like a stem cell transplantation? But now it has changed completely. The patients ask for the result of the minimal residual disease, and they talk to each other on the ward, so they are not any afraid anymore. They know the result, and they know that they are on high risk, and they agree with this approach. This is just an example. There are many other targets, many other antigens, and several antibodies which are under approval. But my impression is also there are so many targets, which means antigens, and so many attempts, only very few of the antibodies available for the treatment are really successful. And I think rituximab, what I showed you, I told you that Roche is earning in the meantime one then more than 1 billion. And the reason is that to their surprise and to the surprise of the doctors, it works also in diseases where you cannot identify a CD20 target population. So the extension to other diseases like immune thrombocytopenia, rheumatoid arthritis, and so is on the way. So the next thing is an example for the next disease I'm discussing shortly with you, is molecular targeting. And the thing is that the researchers in the pharmaceutical industry, they look for molecular or genetic aberrations, and then they try to identify a fusion protein. For instance, the first malignant disease characterized by a chromosomal aberration was a chronic myelocytic leukemia. It's called the Philadelphia chromosome. You know it certainly, and it's a translocation 922. And there, due to this break, there is a fusion protein. And this fusion protein causes the leukemia. You can transfer it to a mice, and the mice develops the leukemia. So it's clearly causative. And they developed Novartis and some people in the United States, particularly a man called Brian Drucker. Several times he did not get a grant from the NCI because he said that it will never work that you develop a specific drug against such a fusion protein. Finally, it works, and again, I'm just telling you, they sell it for more than $1 billion. And so this is a disease, and it was several times published in the newspapers as a so-called Wunderdroge. So I had a lot of patients calling and asking, sending emails, whether they would fit to this treatment. And we have already had at that time prepared a sheet saying, only if you have this chromosomal translocation and this something, something, then you are a candidate. Now it's more evident. So the Philadelphia positive leukemia is the poorest of all outcomes. So 23% at 3 years, it's very poor for leukemia. So the next step was to use an inhibitor called imatinib or Gleevec for this specific Abl tyrosine kinase, and it blocks the signal transduction and the activation of signals which promote the growth of leukemic cells, and it stops it here at this point. And the result, and again, when we had this drug available, the question was, how should we combine it? Should we give it parallel to the chemo? No, Novartis was afraid. They said, don't do things like this. It might be too toxic. And we are just on the way to register the drug, which is understandable. Use it after chemotherapy. This is molecular targeting after the induction. Then we moved forward, and now it's common to give it parallel to chemotherapy. And there are three studies. The complete remission rate of this very, very poor leukemia subtype increased to 95%. It's an MD Houston study. This is a Japanese study. This is our German study. It's now confirmed by others. So there is a total change in outcome just by, and actually what's also important, 50% of those patients have a molecular remission. You cannot detect minimal residual anymore, which is a very important fact. And I will not deal very much with curves, but you have seen the 23% before, and these are now the result of the Asian study, and the others are very similar. Based on this result, because Frankfurt was an initiation center of this Gleevec in adult lymphoblastic leukemia, we initiated a study in elderly patients, because usually the patients above 55, particularly after 65, are not treated very well, and they are neglected, they are often not in the studies. So we designed a study just for the elderly patients, and you see half of our elderly patients above 50 or 60 have this unfavorable subtype, the Philadelphia positive leukemia, and we did a study giving them this imatinib or Gleevec, this Abl tyrosine kinase inhibitor. I'm not a friend of randomized studies, but occasionally it's nice that you are convinced by your youngsters or the company that you have to do it. So we did a study to give elderly patients with a leukemia, even if they had 50 or 100,000 leukemic cells, nothing, just this oral drug as tablets, partly as an outpatient treatment. And the remaining patients received the chemotherapy where we had a complete remission rate before of 43%. And you see 92% of adult patients with acute lymphoblastic leukemia, those elderly patients, achieved a complete remission. They were partly at home, life quality was good, and the most important thing, they did not die from the toxicity of a chemo induction. And you see here the chemo, complete remission, 47%, early death in this chemo arm. And there are now several studies, it needs always to be confirmed. An Italian study, 92%, a French study, our study. So it becomes a standard. It looks very good.